Okay.
You see
green light.
It means it's on.
Okay.
If you want to turn it off, mm-hmm. hold it for like 2 seconds and the light will go on.
Well, I'll keep it. Oh, okay. I can hear myself.
Okay.
Testing 1 2. Testing 1 2. Okay. Is that picking me up? So I need to keep it. Should I put it to my, okay? That makes sense. Yeah, that's better. That's better. Yes, because otherwise I have to keep my head that way. Okay. Perfect. So I'll turn that off now. Testing. Okay, sounds like it's coming through. I think the only thing I'm missing up here is a bottle of water, because I, that's okay. I suspect that given the amount of time that's been allotted for me to speak, that I might get a bit parched. One thing I worry about is having a coughing fit in front of everybody. Oh, that was loud. Okay. So I better not laugh. First of all, I'm going to be conscious of the time. I'm going to dive right into this in just a bit. One second here. Yeah, this is what I was looking for. So I want to say that, first of all, thank you for inviting me and for making me feel so welcome. I want to thank specifically Dr. Brian Doyle and certainly President Matt Schenck, as well as all of the organizers of this particular event here at Marymount, this annual Ethics Awareness Week event, and for frankly inviting me to help kick off this theme of ethics in the arts. And I understand that this is the first time you've had this theme. I'm sort of just double checking to make sure that this is in the right location. And I want to say also that I'm frankly fascinated by the schedule that's been presented here, especially this artscape with a side of ethics. It's got like everything that I'm interested in. Given that I'm a visual artist, I minored in creative writing. I used to sing with the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. The only thing that's missing here is the like a design and build project for the architecture students. I don't know if you have architecture students here. But I also wanted to say real quickly, I saw this question up here, does the artist have social responsibility? My answer is yes. Thank you so much. And what I was going to do, I don't know if it's opening up properly. So like a few, I think it was a few years ago, I published this article, see? Art as social response and responsibility. So yes, the answer is yes. I'm pretty sure that's probably the answer that the speakers came up with, but this is not why I'm here. So I'm going to close that down. I'm going to open up the PowerPoint. And I'm going to go to beginning. And I think I'll get started. The presentation is titled, and once again, let me know can you hear me if I'm doing this? You can hear me well? Okay, so I don't have to like talk into the mic. Okay. So the title of the presentation is Human Rights, Human Response, The Inalienable Architecture of Creative Activity as a Catalyst for Our Liberty as Social Creatures. And Dr. Doyle mentioned that some students were trying to figure out the title. And I knew that would be the case because you hadn't heard the presentation. So how would you know what I'm talking about yet? But I like the tag that he came up with, Art Will Set You Free. And I sort of incorporated it into the presentation. And I hope that this makes sense to you as we go along. Okay? So now, I don't know, I know that you're filming this, so I'm going to get started with a swig of water. Obscured by the passage of time, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen that was passed by France's National Constituent Assembly in August of 1789 is a fundamental document of the French Revolution and in the history of human rights. It declares the individual and collective rights of all the estates of the realm as universal. The key drafts of this declaration were written and presented to the National Assembly by French aristocrat and American Revolutionary War hero, an officer, Marquis de Lafayette, and was directly influenced by Thomas Jefferson, who contributed to the writing of this document by drawing upon the 1776 Virginia Declaration of Rights by George Mason, as well as his own drafts of the American Declaration of Independence. The tenets of this declaration were also obscured to me, personally, until I recently watched a film that I had never seen before, starring the great Charles Laughton, a bit of American war propaganda filmed during World War II titled This Land Is Mine. Especially since there's a film studies group here, I suggest if you've never seen it, rent it, or film it, or show it. In any case, this film was set in an unnamed Nazi-occupied village somewhere in Europe. That's the title card. The story depicts the actions of an initially cowardly school teacher as he develops the courage to join the underground resistance, resistance movement, and the willingness ultimately to sacrifice his life. At the end of the film, just before his arrest and seizure by the Nazis, he recites a few of these articles from the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen, as many as he can, squeezing it in just before he gets taken away. He recites them to a classroom of young children. And this particular article, Article 4, jumped out to me. And it reads, as you can see, liberty consists in the power to do whatever does not harm another. And by the way, let me say something real quickly. When I, as I go through this presentation, some of the slides will be directly drawing from the text, and some of the slides will be metaphors representative of an idea, of the concept underlying what I'm talking about. So, be prepared to sort of code switch in your head in terms of what the image is representing. But anyway, once again, this particular article jumped out to me. Now, in context, Article 4 charges every man and woman to do no harm to a fellow citizen and assures that the exercise of one's natural rights are not to be curtailed unless it harms other members of that society by preventing their enjoyment of the very same rights. And yet we harm each other each day. We post videos of citizens harming one another. We market and monetize doing harm to one another. In doing so, perhaps we prove ourselves unworthy of liberty, which, by the way, is not enacted by political parties. We'll get more to that in a bit. The obverse, the opposite of Article 4, is also true. Liberty consists in the architecture of whatever benefits, the building or construction of whatever benefits or advantages another. Individuals construct liberty communally. Now, I want to talk about these constructs in my next book on creativity, or as I like to clarify, creative activity. I want to talk about these as a natural and human right, and that's also the subject of this presentation today, creativity or creative activity as a natural or human right. Now, if asked, if we're being honest, most people will offer that art's primary purpose is either to provide beauty or a means for self-expression. But this is at best a superficial claim. Yes, art is ubiquitous. It's everywhere. But that's not because beauty beckons to be expressed in every society and era of civilization. Because the truth is that art represents lived experience. And because of that, art is often very ugly or represents ugly aspects of humanity and the human experience. Upon closer scrutiny, art is everywhere, in every time, in every nation, because its primary function is to re-energize the process of human development. Consequently, I would argue that the right to create is as inalienable as any other human right and is equally implicit in our rights to life and liberty. Like honey in a hive, art is both food and fuel. It is produced for others and is intended for mutual consumption. It yields immediate satisfaction in addition to the energy for new creative activity. As an essential component of the human experience and its replenishment, access to the arts or access to creative activity and the opportunity to engage in creative acts is a basic human need, just as is access to any other kind of energy for perpetuating life and vitality, such as food or water or the raw materials for fuel. Likewise, as a principal component of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, everyday access to the arts or sustainable design or livable architecture or creative activity and the opportunity to engage in creative acts that generate them is arguably a fundamental, natural, and human right, no less self-evident or inalienable than the right to exercise private judgment or the right to equal estimation of one another's core human being. It is a natural right in that we each have the right not to be denied access to congregate in social networks of the creative activity of our choosing. It is a human right in that we each have the right to access the highest achievements of our kind, our art and all of its diverse manifestations. And yet, once again, human rights of all kinds are clearly being denied every day, aren't they? So that the significance of understanding creative activity as a human right is, at least one primary significance to me, is that it forces a renewed examination of why and how creativity is so readily obscured and regularly denied to so many. There's a, if you go on YouTube, there's a little experiment that I've written about and that you can find. Where I think it was a teaching artist came into an elementary school to do a project with all the grade levels and ask a basic question to the kindergartners and first graders. Who here thinks they're an artist? Who here thinks they're creative? Raise your hand. All the hands in the class go up, right? Go to second grade, third grade, fourth grade. By the time you get to fourth grade, fifth grade, same question. Who here thinks that they're an artist? Who here feels that they're creative? About half the hands go up. Right? And this is on film. And by the time you get to 12th grade, who here feels that they're creative? Who here feels they're an artist? One hand ekes up sort of tentatively. Right? And there's something that's going on in schooling, in the schooling process, which seems to negate the sense that we are all creative beings made in the image of a creator, right? Somehow that's something is going on that needs to be addressed, and this is a part of why I give this kind of conversation and presentation. So once again, it goes back to my point. What is it that's going on that and we need to examine this, that denies creativity to so many, that obscures the sense of one being creative to so many. So in the book that this presentation, because this what I'm talking about today is going to be a chapter in a book I think I'm going to call The Creative Continuum. It's a follow-up book to this book here, Swarm Intelligence, What Nature Teaches Us About Shaping Creative Leadership. I want to extend the argument that I began here in this book. The argument being that while it's long been assumed that creativity is an individual trait and that intellectual achievement is essentially personal potential fulfilled, in actuality, humanity's greatest creative achievements are always the byproduct of our swarm intelligence. That is, our capacity for collective creative activity and our ability to assimilate each mutually adaptive advantage that activity produces. Understanding creativity as a human right matters because, perhaps more than ever before, a majority of global citizens are aware of the limits of their own access to the wealth and privileges of those in the top tier of ownership and power, who seem to enjoy no denial of access at all to whatever is wished. The hope of access to enrichment and new possibilities is, for instance, the primary motivator for the proliferation of state lotteries across the United States. Now, this shouldn't matter in people's lives as much as it does, but it does. But what if we understood creative activity and innovation as a continuum, as privilege without borders, so to speak? What if we recognize that the consequences of creative behavior cannot be contained? Or that creativity is a gift that keeps on giving? This is a crucial question because if creativity originates as a social behavior, not as an individual trait, the outcomes of our creativity are likewise amplified whenever we share our ideas or our materials, the tools or tools in schools or in the workplace or even at home on our own time. If creativity originates as a social behavior, everything changes with regard to how we foster creativity. I'm sorry, I lost my place here. Everything changes in terms of how we foster creativity, both in ourselves and in those we love. Nothing could be more important, because if creativity originates as a social behavior, our creativity is both the continuing evidence and the continuing means for the success of every individual, every family, every classroom, every society, every company, and every nation. Therefore, in this talk, I want to provoke a few questions that you've likely never considered before. What if the right to signify self, to model one's life experience, and to contest prevailing norms through our creative acts was understood as a basic human right? What if one's creative activity is neither one's personal property nor one's private advantage? What if, rather than competing merely to dominate our neighbors and secure our preeminence in a contest for the survival of the fittest, we competed in a far greater contest for the survival of the patterns that sustain our better selves? Finally, how will art set you free? The opportunity to render meaning from life and thereby leave the best of yourself behind can be argued as a basic human right largely because all people, all cultures, and all civilizations at one point or another assert the agency to represent to others that they changed the world or added to the world's gene pool of great ideas or simply existed. To assert anything less would be to embrace meaninglessness. It might even be argued that the most crucial of all human rights includes the right to make your mark, model your most valued experiences, and map out your affinities, your aspirations, your beliefs, and your counter stories. Without the liberty to tag oneself as a person that matters, to transmit one's personal and social experience to others without censorship, and to make special one's place in the world without assault or prohibition or diminishment, human agency is curtailed. Agency is conceived here not as the freedom to do whatever whatever the subject wills, but rather as the freedom to constitute oneself in an unexpected manner, to decode and recode one's identity. So I once had a student named Ian. As it might have been mentioned, I used to be an elementary school art teacher. Now, Ian was a daydreamer, a quiet child with a crackling imagination who reminded me of myself when I was a third grader. Sometimes when Ian was drawing, I could audibly pick out his soft voice in the murmur of the busy art studio, rehearsing to no one in particular the dialogue that he placed in the mouths of the characters that he had created, along with the sound effects of their interactions. Ian was full of tacit knowledge That is the kind of knowledge that you can't quite state in words about the creatures of our natural world as well as the fire-breathing creatures he would concoct and personify in his imagination. This portrait, this is a portrait, self-portrait. I often did these with my students in special situations. My background is as a portrait artist. I would do these collaborations where the students would draw a setting, a background that they felt comfortable living in, and I would draw them. And sometimes we did it the other way around. So anyway, this is Ian. This particular portrait, self-portrait, is sort of a dialogue between Ian and myself. A visual translation of some of the things that he knew and vividly daydreamed that, but that was not yet adept in verbally telling. When Ian was in fourth grade, I involved him and all of his classmates in a political cartooning project. Since we were still in the wake of the 2004 presidential election, and the buzz of the conversation about the candidates was still going on amongst the kids and their families at home, I proposed the idea of having each student create his or her own political cartoon. I explained that a political cartoon was a commentary on current events that expresses an opinion and serves to persuade others by its appearance in the public conversation. My goal was to open up the pedagogical space for students to construct their own liberty and to be as critical, as perspicacious, and as opinionated as they chose to be. So Ian chose to represent his affection and concern for wild animals as their space is being invaded. In this image that you see here, Ian advocates the natural rights of animals not to have their habitat destroyed, as he depicts how those who wield weapons and hunt for sport also cause the home of these forest creatures to be engulfed in flames. In this next image, Ian expresses what needs to be done to establish a new order where, under the watchful eye of animals, men hose down the conflagration that they ignited. Hegemony is confronted. As a precursor to these, to this particular political cartooning exercise, I asked each fourth grader to name and pictorialize an injustice in the world today, or at that time of that day, that he or she wanted to help make better. And that was a way of introducing the idea of social justice to a fourth grader. Ian's visual documentation thus represented his ethical choice. Given the need of the moment, it was the right thing to do, what the fellow with the hose is doing. In the earliest of the drawings of his social justice concerns that would ultimately become his final political cartoon, one views a large spotted cat exercising her right to protect her home, looking down from a tree branch and confronting a man holding a chainsaw with the words, "What are you doing?" In the next image, we view the defense of these animals' natural rights, validated by a diversity of animals, presenting a representative majority in opposition to the lone man with the chainsaw, while the cat's cubs, which you can see up in the tree, arrayed with black belts, noisily practice their martial arts repertoire in the tree's protective canopy. You see them saying, don't make me come down there. Take that. In this particular image, you see an impending war against the machines of hegemony preparing to mow down all natural rights as the animals are sort of band together to prepare and defend their domain. And this is before the movie Avatar, by the way. Finally, this is the final political cartoon, which we posted on our school's website, all the cartoons. And this is, he finally titled it Stay Away from the Tree. And you see the dialogue from the cubs in the tree changes from the posturing statement, "Don't make me come down there," to the more confident, "Can we get the man with the chainsaw?" And this is the final rendering, inked up. So the practice of interpreting and reinterpreting personal and communal meaning, or decoding and recoding the meaning of one's identity, is the art of self-determination. It would be simplistic to assume that acts of self-determination, just because of the feature word self, are primarily self-serving. That's not really the case. Self-determination is also an agency for social growth. Art educator Olivia Goudet points out the role of self-determination in the development of democracy and vigorous community exchange. When she writes, it is useful to remember that as educators, we create citizens of a democratic society, not so much by filling students with ideas or facts about democracy, as by creating the conditions through which youth experience the pleasures, anxieties, and responsibilities of democratic life. Creating conditions for students and teachers as agents of non-hierarchical learning communities that afford ample opportunity for its members to self-determine their contributions to a democratic society also allows each of our own moments of jazz, wherein we consciously integrate our perceptions into a complex constructions, a complicated conversation, and habitually act on the basis of our deepest awarenesses. There are countless historical incidents that can be cited where the residuals of an arts practice or creative activity went beyond mere public demands for the protection of human rights, went beyond being about something needed, and instead became the very thing that was needed. For instance, the Harlem Renaissance and the Black Arts Movement were actually human rights movements. Picasso's Cubist monochromatic painting of Guernica innovated a new form for relating the trauma of war atrocities. The populism and protest of Woody Guthrie's This Land Is Your Land, or just like the defiant pride of James Brown, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, were musically broadcast to inform the United States citizens of beliefs rarely manifested in the public square. The documentary photographs of Louis Wicks Hines, this is a boy, child laborer, coal miner, these were activist texts and catalysts for the transformation of workplace policies allowing the use of and abuse of child labor in industry. Each of these works of art was an act of self-determination and a needed contribution to democratic life, whether embodying the triumph over trauma or extending the ethical imagination or contributing toward the dismantling of oppressive legacies simply because of their inescapable emergence into the national sight lines and dialogue. Each time an artistic act distills meaning from experience, it also enriches the exchange of ideas throughout the global commons. To see the arts as a means of social interpretation and reinterpretation and as a catalyst for personal, interpersonal, and social exchange and development, one must first see the arts as an adaptive, dynamic, goal-seeking, self-preserving, and sometimes evolutionary system for perpetuating the human species. And I'm quoting there from Donella Meadows, who writes a brilliant book on systems thinking. I thus claim the arts as much more than a generator of activist manifestos, much more than a universal language for self-expression, or a means for crafting meaningful objects with technical precision. In 1776, Richard Price wrote, and this is on the screen, wrote of that principle of spontaneity or self-determination, which constitutes us agents, or which gives us a command over our actions, a command that this child would not have had, by the way, rendering them properly ours, and not effects of the operation of any foreign cause or external oppressor. And in the case of child labor, society itself became the oppressor. In this light, access to arts practices are also an extension of the same inalienable right, a means of self-determination, in which we work not only to aggregate and accommodate and assimilate ways of thinking not initially our own, but to disseminate the acquired resources of our own intellect to others. So without the right to represent or represent as one sees fit, one's identity, one's lived experiences, one's environmental frames of reference, individuals become invisible. This collective work is not, this is work that's not the work of a lone genius or lone geniuses. It's the work of collective genius applied by autonomous individuals in remarkably diverse ways. To understand swarm intelligence, we must graduate our understanding from insect swarms and beyond animal herds and flocks to the dense clusters of human and social interaction that produce cultures. The human swarm is a social network of individual actors behaving for a time like-mindedly or self-similarly. Thus, a human swarm is a system of individual actors behaving relationally. This is not an either-or condition. Each of us are both and. We are correspondents. We produce idiosynchronous ideas while we are at the same time, manifest and reproduce synchronous thinking, the synchronous thinking of our families, of our profession, of our nation, of our peer groups, of our subcultures. We are entirely capable of leading and following after one another at the same time. Therefore, a human swarm, like all swarms, is a superorganism. This is a sort of a metaphor. By definition, a superorganism exhibits, superorganisms exhibit a form of distributed intelligence, a system in which many individual agents with limited intelligence, each of us is limited, right? And limited information are able to pool resources to accomplish goals that are beyond the capabilities of the individuals. In other words, a swarm intelligence. For those who, just as an explanation of what swarm intelligence is. Finally, a human swarm is not typically instigated by secreted chemical pheromones like insects, or by the fight or flight response that forms either a stampeding herd or what's called a murmuration of swooping starlings when they sort of like dodge and dart throughout the sky as one. It's not really, we're a little bit more sophisticated than that. Most often, a swarm of human activity is instigated, and this is important that you get. Most often, a swarm of human activity is instigated by a common story, whether a crowd of three or a nation of millions. It does not matter whether that story is fictional, or if that story is mythical, or experiential, or scientific, or cultural, or artistic, or political, or economic. Because the truth is that anyone can carry multiple stories in our heads at one time, where all of our core stories actually constantly interact to shape our shifting identities. As artists, we must learn to see our works of art, or our works of design, or architecture as the storytelling exercises that they are. We use symbols and constructed materials to describe our experience of the world immediately around us, to communicate the people, the places, the phenomena, and the events that we value and hold dear and want to survive long after we're gone, and to interrogate the problems that won't go away. Story inventions are shared for ideas, in order for ideas to spread. A religion is a story invention, just like a code of ethics, just like a body of laws, just like a political party platform statement, just like a manifesto declaring a new movement in the art world, or an economic theory. None of these ideas exist as objects or locations in the material world. You cannot see them, you can't touch them, you can't smell them, you can't eat them or climb them or bury down into them as if they were shelter. They exist as imagined concepts held in mind. And yet, every day, human beings organize activities or identities or cooperative behaviors around such stories, the stories that we tell one another. In fact, we will often fight each other and die to preserve those story models that mean the most to us, even though they don't exist, once again, in the natural and biological world. This is yet another way that human swarms differ from other animal and insect swarms. We develop new systems of behavior around open scaffolds, flexible architectural constructs, serving as catalysts for our own liberty, either to behave distinctly or to behave likewise. We daily surpass the behavior, for instance, of a colony of chimpanzees, marshaling the best of our energies, cooperating by thousands or even by the millions, not simply in order to gather food or to maintain shelter from danger, or even to pick the parasites off of one another's hair. Frankly, we seem to share stories just for the sake of enticing and joining in the decision-making activities with a diversity of strangers, activities bound to yield unpredictable outcomes where little may initially be known. This is why the history of artistic and scientific revolutions looks very much like the history of social revolutions. Groups, and this is on the screen, groups of autonomous individuals with a shared affinity for a particular story construct, self-organized to participate in activities as that story deems apt, without the need for outside direction, ultimately distributing the results of their problem solving between one another through multiple interactions over time. In so doing, they mimic one another's behavior and outcomes until an unexpected adaptation emerges, a continuum activity producing a creative leap that no one individual could have generated on his or her own. In a recent TED talk presenting ideas from his best-selling book, Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind, Yuval Noah Harari argues that humans control the planet because they are the only animals that cooperate both flexibly and in very large numbers. Now, there are other animals, like the social insects, bees, and ants, that can cooperate in large numbers, but they don't do so very flexibly. Their cooperation is very rigid. There's basically only one way in which a beehive can function. And there's a new, and if there's a new opportunity for a new danger, the bees cannot reinvent the social system overnight. They cannot, for example, execute the queen and establish a republic of bees or a communist dictatorship of worker bees. Now, I argue, in sort of playing on that, that it is our capacity to generate stories to live by that allows humans to cooperate so flexibly in both improvisational and ritualized creative activities, whether in small groups or in large groups, in organized and sustained intellectual cultural movements that range from the local to the global, often with no requirement of ever having met before, or no intimate knowledge of one another, often across the boundaries of time and space, following only the words printed in a book, or the symbols in a work of art, or the equations recorded in a scientific equation. It is our capacity to generate stories to live by that allows humans to maneuver from swarm to swarm to swarm, often maintaining simultaneous membership in each and every one, and exhibiting radically different behaviors depending on which one they're in at that time, whether they're at the cafeteria table with the ROTC cadets, or at another table with the varsity jocks, or another table with the art geeks, or with the math nerds, or at home with their own family members, or in your house of worship, or on the job, multiple identities manifesting themselves with each different swarm. Now, whether through the arts or scientific discourse communities, or our political and business enterprises, our story constructs bind us into distinct cultures and civilizations in the ongoing management of the surplus energies that this behavior produces, ideally agreeing to mutually benefit one another so that enduring social structures might be erected. This quote is from a book that you probably don't know, by George Bataille. On the whole, a society produces more than is necessary for its survival. It has a surplus at its disposal. It is precisely the use it makes of the surplus that determines it. The surplus is the cause of the agitation, of the structural changes of the entire history of society. But the surplus has more than one outlet. And the most common of which is growth. The growth itself has many forms, each one of which eventually comes up against some limit. So now, George Bataille, his writing is inspired by the anthropological writings of a sociologist named Marcel Mauss. And he presents a concept, that we give of gift transmissions as an alternative to the primacy of, say, commodity exchanges or capitalist exchanges, the idea of gift transmissions. So his basic premise was that our natural social interaction, the natural social interaction of human beings, generates an excess of energy, and that energy has to be expended. and it's consumed in one way or the other. Either it's converted and enlarged into creative, sometimes sacred transmissions that branch upward and flower our humanity and serve no other purpose than to help other human beings become more human, or that surplus energy turns into aggression and often crushing other human rights as fodder for that individual or for that community. So this surplus energy, and I want to sort of key on this in a bit as I sort of try to work my way to a conclusion here. This surplus energy, he calls the accursed share, because it can be turned into something that is very, very ugly. And it's a conundrum, because how do we get this, direct this energy that we produce as we live towards the exercise of becoming more human? Well, that leads to the question, what is it to be more human? At our most altruistic, we give little bits of ourselves away, because such are the actions that hold us together. We either, and this is now, take the lens of arts, right? We either form beautifully crafted reflections of the world that we've experienced, or we inform new ideas emerging from ongoing and complicated conversations and cultural legacies. Or we transform present conditions into future questions and possibilities and contest prevailing norms. These are the things that the energy of art making and creative activity can do at its best, at its ideal. There's no personal profit to be gained from this activity. It's not a commodity exchange. It's a gift transmission, going back to Georges Bataille. So if you once again brought up my goal here is to try to help you see the arts and design and creative activity in a way that's beyond the paradigm that we typically limit ourselves to seeing it, right? So think of it as seeing it as a gift transmission, seeing it as something that helps to flower our humanity, and oftentimes to the extent of becoming a sacred transmission, right? An echo of the Creator, right? If we look at that kind of collective wealth, we understand that there's much more to distribute at the end of these exchanges that we have one another, these artistic aesthetic exchanges, than originally invested by the parties involved. So I want to talk a little bit now, I make the quote over here, art literally sets us free to be all that we can be. I want to talk a little bit about that topic that I mentioned about what happens in schooling. And I want to talk a little bit about a guy named Frederick Winslow Taylor, who's known as the father of scientific management. Because I want to touch, I'm not going to be able to crack it all open now, but I do want to touch on it a little bit. So who's Frederick Winslow Taylor? He's the father of scientific management, a pioneer of introducing and melding modern concepts of industrial efficiency into the enterprise of public education. And he came into the fore, his ideas came to the fore, his ideas came and was incorporated into schooling largely between, at the turn of the century, early 1900s. It was at a time when there was a crisis in American education, and there was a fear that the influx of immigrant students was going to, it needed either to be converted into assets for the nation, or they were going to ultimately disrupt and detract from the growth of the American economic empire. So Taylor was consulted, and he came in with certain ideas about efficiency, which are still enforced today and are an ongoing mechanism and the denial of the right, I would argue, of creative activity in schooling. First, Taylor mandated the replacement of autonomously scripted rule of thumb. And the idea of rule of thumb comes from, you know, the idea that if you take your thumb from nail to knuckle, typically for most adults is about an inch. And it's a great way if you're in a workplace environment of figuring out measurements on the spot. And that's where the term rule of thumb comes from, by the way. So anyway, he was very much against the idea of autonomously scripted rule of thumb workplace methods coming from individuals, and sought the single best, and argued for the single best scientifically determined method for doing any task. Anything other than the method determined by management was considered a waste of time and money. With this, when this mandate was replicated in an educational context, opportunities for learners to independently problem solve without directives from their teachers are severely curtailed, which is ultimately a denial of their right to creativity. Second, Taylor's system also required a scientific selection and training and development of each employee, rather than leaving employees to mimic one another and develop new adaptations on their own. Or as Taylor once put it to a mechanic who worked underneath him, common laborers are not supposed to think because there are other people paid to do the thinking around here. Taylor argued that one type of man is needed to plan ahead and an entirely different type of man is needed to execute the work. When adopted into schools, this leads to or has led to the imposition of tasks to pupils, whether they like it or not. The assumption is that the teacher or the manager is solely responsible for devising and planning activities and projects, and this ultimately serves to underdevelop the creative capacity in students, or in a professional workforce, or throughout society, and once again a denial of natural and human rights. Taylor's scientific management system also required the provision of detailed instruction and supervision, ensuring that workers were applying all principles precisely as instructed in their performance and completion of each assigned task, so much so that the stopwatch became emblematic of Taylor's system, often likened to management by measurement. Taylor's approach was applied in schools, and the completion of homework assignments, sequenced workbooks, and timed tests became the order of the school day. So think about it. Workbooks are essentially books of assignments and their rules, conditioning tools in which the teacher introduces changes, notes effects, and maintains full control of the design of the student. Workbooks are analogous to any and all means of social regimentation. These are really conditioning books and are used in order to measure an individual's gradual acquisition and application of instructional or institutional content. But they also serve to underdevelop the possibility of the unexpected question or the unscripted response. And fourth, Taylor insisted on a strict division of labor between management and workers so that managers carried the burden of analyzing and planning and controlling the whole manufacturing process, and each worker carried the burden of only doing what he or she was told to do. Management-focused schooling models this mandate and views the highest student achievers as those who come out best conditioned to perform in accord with standardized rules, regulations, and assessment metrics. It's in the cultivation of cadres of individual achievers content on meeting the prevailing standard and nothing more, the ability to inclination to produce surplus energies to benefit others is ultimately suppressed. So, as we move to a conclusion here, in our consideration of ethics in the arts, what can you or I do to support the right to create? When I was a student in the High School of Art and Design in New York City, and this is one of my portraits, color pencil portraits, I sometimes chose to give my art away. It's important to note that this is very out of character for me because I'm a very, very, very methodical art maker. It takes a lot of time, and to this day, I'm quite content if my work stays in my studio and surrounds me. I've rarely even sold my art, and for me to choose to give something away that I had toiled to craft and shape, it had to strike me that someone else needed it more than I did. I also started writing poetry in high school for the sole reason of addressing it to friends of mine who were downcast. I knew what it felt like to suffer in silence as an introverted and isolated teen. And when I saw someone else at the risk of being swallowed in the same kind of emotional abyss that I had barely escaped myself, I doubled back through artistic portals with the hope that I could help reveal an escape route. And as I reflect back, I realize that I was intentionally practicing art as an altruistic exercise. Why? What response was I attempting to trigger in the receiver of my gifts and my gift transmission? It's clear now, that at the time I sought little more than to state, I was once in your shoes, and I know a way to a better position, follow me. I sought no personal profit from these exchanges. Altruism, and I'm quoting Wilson, an art educator, altruism is recognized as a cultural behavior, gift transmission, well beyond instinctive behavior, and even beyond adaptive social behaviors with respect to evolutionary processes. It is a cultural behavior that does not appear at first to contribute to the survival of the species. But taking a second look, the smallest acts of altruism or gift transmission have a way of spreading, of blooming, like creative contagions, into huge social advantages, the stuff that cultures and economies are made of. Perhaps it's time to build an alternative economy for education, one that induces more creative energy than originally invested, enticing the development of unexpected social advantages rather than indoctrinating learners merely to increase the wealth of nations. A pedagogy of those bereft of creative activity, that is, a pedagogy of renewal and adaptive creative transmissions, perhaps is a new blueprint for public education, wherein instructional goals and policies are rewritten to facilitate learning by behaving together, each one contributing his or her surplus energies in order to benefit and build up the world we share. The great puzzle to closing the achievement gap between the educational outcomes of those privileged to have and those presumed to have not is solved by increasing the regular access of all students to provocative, positive sum exchanges, as opposed to zero sum exchanges, where if you lose, I win. Transmissions of the best of ourselves in search of no particular personal or corporate profit, but rather intended to entice similarly advantageous behaviors in the lives of those whom we have shared. What have we to exchange? All that we are and more. That has always been more than enough. I suggest that I was, I think President Schenck mentioned that this particular school has is sort of in the vanguard of diversity amongst campuses, regionally or otherwise. And I want to talk a little bit to close on diversity. I suggest that the most effective schools open up a space for diverse individuals to come together, to interact in diverse environments, and self-organize so that new behavioral attitudes and trajectories can coalesce and emerge. Unexpected turns of events. Any attempt to turn a school of thought into a members-only club ultimately starves it. In fact, aptitude within the creative continuum of human relations flows directly from my relationships with those I behave together with, whether mentors or with teachers or with affinity group peers. Capacity remains empty without connections to those who are willing to come alongside and energize me out of their own store of experience and information. The rules of the creative swarm are actually really simple. Follow the trail of the fish in front. And if there are any ahead, keep pace with the fish beside you. No one starts off more creative than the next person. Each of us starts off in need of momentum. Everyone's gift is the same. Our unique life experiences and our ability to select our affinities, share information, and connect with others along the way toward a common good. One person does not constitute a movement. Each of us can contribute critical mass and energy to the movements we are enticed to attach ourselves to. I'll leave you with this simple premise. Communities of ethical practice thrive on diversity. The purpose of schools is to open up the space for diverse individuals once again to come together, interact, and self-organize so that new behavioral attitudes and trajectories can coalesce and emerge. That is to say that you are creative because I am creative. I am creative because you are creative. What you can do, I can do likewise. Where one of us goes, the other may follow. What I use to make do, you can use too. What you leave behind, I can make better use of. What I have built, you can build on top of. Creativity is a systematic replication of prior creative activity. As a result, we are all the inhabitants of a creative continuum. Imagination is a catalyst for that creativity, which is the catalyst for culture and for civilization, which is the catalyst for greater imaginings. In other words, all creative activity forms an interactive loop and is activated within a continuous ecology of human achievement. in June 1965 at a commencement address in Oberlin College in Ohio, Nobel Prize laureate Dr. Martin Luther King stated, "All I'm saying is simply this, that all mankind is tied together. All life is interrelated, and we're all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. For some strange reason, I can never be what I ought until you are what you are to be. And you can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be. And this is the interrelated structure of reality." Although Dr. King was reflecting on the subject of injustice, the implications of this inescapable network are as generative as they are corrective. How far is its reach? The ties that bind us are also serve as the tethers that we must use to enlarge the height and perimeter of our tents. The ties that bind us are also the ropes that we must use to in our shared climb to the next human plateau. This inescapable network of mutuality represents the creative continuum of human achievement. Within this continuum, creative outcomes are never authored and initiated solely through a single creative agent. Rather, our greatest achievements are always transactional, responsive, relational. Within this continuum, creative activity is fundamentally an ethical project, the ongoing exercise of symbiotic or shared moral principles for self-fulfillment, self-determination, and mutual investment. According to researcher Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, what we call creativity always involves a change in the governing system, a governing symbolic system or otherwise. A change that will in turn affect the thoughts and feelings of the members of that culture. Through that lens, all individuals have an equal right to stir up changes as we live in and move through local governing systems, as we make our presences felt to varying degrees. We each have the right to create change or new meaning. We each have the right to create our own approach to language and conversation. We each have the right to create an identity in the world and rehearse new actions. As youngsters, we each have the right to create wild stories, imaginary friends, and playful diversions. We each have the right to ask new questions as we experience our local worlds. When you or I walk through a space, we each have the right to create a unique trajectory or pathway. We have the survival instinct to create relationships with one another, and we have the right to create common beliefs and situational behaviors and choose from an array of possible responses. We have the right to create change. We have the right to create culture. We have the right to create civilization. We have the right to create order or disorder. We have the right to create havoc. We have the right to procreate, to recreate, or to recreate. When we indict a youngster or a neighbor or even yourself of not being creative, this is arguably less a matter of some sort of innate psychological deficit than of barriers to the access to access and circumstances and agency offered within governing systems for the stories that we live by. There's ultimately much to gain when we start to look beyond the story of creativity as one of individual achievement, and rather as a redirection of the momentum of the larger social swarm. When the full arc of the narrative of creative activity comes into sharp focus, we see this, that creativity is literally human development in action. Thank you for your time and your attention. Oh, sir, cool, good. Cool. I told you I couldn't laugh with this thing. Well, sorry about that. That's the rolling laugh, by the way. It's sort of a booming thing, same as the rolling sneeze. Sorry about that. And this, by the way, I'll say one thing real quickly, which is that presentations like this, like I said, this is intended to be, I took the opportunity to write this up and explore this, and I knew that ultimately there'll be a chapter in some project that I'm working on. So your feedback is valuable. Questions, dialogue, because it helps me to anticipate questions that someone else will have later on, right? Or a dialogue that needs to be addressed. So I'm open to anything or comments or whatever. I'll be careful not to laugh again. Well, that's a really good question. And a good way of thinking about it is what happens when when a contemporary or current civilization encounters the artwork and architecture and residuals of a previous civilization? Does it mean the same thing that that culture or those artists and artisans meant? Not necessarily, right? Sometimes it often becomes reinterpreted. Right, it often becomes a catalyst for new invention when some forgotten process is rediscovered and merges with the current process. And it doesn't. If you are interested in translating and learning what that art meant for that culture, that's certainly a worthy enterprise. But I think one of the reasons why we leave the best of ourselves behind as residuals is because it's meant to proliferate and become something else. It's meant to move us all forward. Even if that's not intended, it always happens, right? When we encounter the work, or even if someone here encounters a film that they've never seen before by a filmmaker, or a piece of music that you've never heard before, or a piece of artwork that becomes a catalyst for your creative activity that would not have happened unless you had that encounter, the same thing happens. Proliferation, unexpected outcomes. I don't think it's necessarily intended for it to be read as intended, because it's meant to seed the gene pool of ideas, right? And so that those genetics become new cultures or new permutations. I wouldn't be in the business that I'm in if I didn't believe that was possible. The problem is multiple. I think the core of the issue is that paradigm stories matter, and the stories that we have about what art is and what art is for, it shapes our thinking and our behavior and our policies. And so if you only think of art as something that's supposed to be hung in museums or on refrigerators, and you don't think of it as something that saves lives or that is a catalyst for new innovation, if you don't see art as absolutely related to design and architecture and filmmaking, if you don't see it as a continuum related to creative writing, if you don't see that, it becomes partitioned, and it becomes it loses its robustness. It becomes stayed and stagnant, and it doesn't do what art visibly does it, because we all know what culture is. We all know what culture is, right? We all know that every civilization and every nation has its own cultures and set of subcultures. We know that that happens, but we don't. Somehow we lose the idea because we think about art as only this, as only self-expression, and that's it, right? Many of us do, right? It's the first thing we think of. Oh, art is for expressing ourselves. We express ourselves in countless ways, right? It's not just for expressing ourselves. It's for it builds models. It's a culture. Why does one tattoo one's skin with a body art with as a memoriam? That's not about creating beauty. It's about something else, right? Something could be beautiful, but it's certainly about something else. So part of it is getting beyond definitions, and changing the story. So once you begin to change the story and begin to tell and talk about art and creativity as a right, as a necessity, as opposed to simply being nice, right? That's how you begin to change the dynamic within schools, which don't really see it as crucial, as even though it's right in front of their face, that it's crucial. We don't see it as crucial because we understand art as that those activities that our art teacher did with us that didn't really mean a lot. We were just busy work, right? But when I ask my students to create a social, to explore social justice by creating a political cartoon, well, that's far more than creating something for the refrigerator, right? So so I think part of it is changing those stories. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a hand there.
Thanks. This goes again to your experience in the classroom as a fourth grade teacher, as well as to your discussion of who was it, Dr. Taylor, and putting strict regulations on who does what and how. As an educator, both then and now, and I find in my classroom, I'm a teacher, I struggle with this. How do you negotiate the space between doing the assignment, doing what I asked you to do, and satisfying that creative aspect? Well, because I have kids who they say, "Oh, I want to be creative," and I had to say, "Well, you also didn't do the assignment." So I don't want to discourage their creativity. I want the classroom to be a space where they can explore that. But at the same time, I have things I'm trying to teach them, and they're not accomplishing what we need to be accomplishing if I let them go too far afield. So do you have maybe any advice for negotiating the space between the two?
Well, I think so. I often developed projects and ideas for projects in collaboration with students, thinking about curriculum not as something that I handed out, but as something that we created together, curriculum as being some sort of emergent property from my interest, their interest, what was happening in the world. I remember one third grader remarked to me one day, how can we learn so much social studies in the art classroom? And I said, well, because the arts are about how society interacts. So to me, there was no difference between, it was interesting to me that he saw this as some sort of bringing something that was partitioned, when to me it was clearly all a conversation about what we do as human beings, the human experience. So that's a part of it, is how you come up with the projects. I think it's important, obviously, to build skills and to teach techniques in order to achieve some sort of intended outcome. And I think that you have to look at them in tandem. The idea of arts as a meaning-making activity, and than giving the tools to allow meaning to be constructed. I'm not even sure if I answered the question, but I do think that the effort to negotiate is a worthy one, and I encourage you to keep it up. And if you have any questions about that, my role these days is as the editor of Art Education Journal, and what I like to do is we get feedback, we get articles submitted from teachers in the classroom. I always point out that the learning that takes place in art classrooms, unless arts teachers tell that story, no one else tells that story, right? So sometimes it's good to look at what other teachers are doing to help you model some new practices and develop new practices for your classroom. And if you want to touch base on some of the things that you're doing, I'll be glad to do that. You saw my email address at jrowling@syr.edu. So I don't know if I answered the question, but I think I would like to keep this conversation going.
Thank you.
Sure.
So could you comment? There seems to be an inherent paradox in the swarm, and I think back to your metaphor of the anthill, that the swarm acting as a collective can act collectively, creatively, and bring about substantive change, but that individually we need to sacrifice a little bit of our own creatively. If each of those ants started going in their own direction and doing their own thing, it wouldn't be able to bring about that change. So could you talk just a little bit about wanting to act in the swarm as a collective to do very, very creative things, but do we need to sacrifice maybe a teeny bit of our individual creativity to bring about that greater good?
That's a good question. One of the first reactions that folks often have with the idea of human beings thinking like a swarm is there are negative connotations that sometimes immediately, like the Borg collective and Star Trek, folks that don't think individually at all, but only think as a collective. One of the things that I try to point out, that this is not an either or position. We both follow and lead at the same time, right? It's simultaneous. It's often cyclical, wherein. The reason why I speak English is because I was part of a family, a small swarm, that spoke English. And if I grew up in a household where Spanish was the primary language, I would speak Spanish today. Now, that's where I first learned to speak. But the sentences I speak to you now are not any sentences that any of my family ever spoke before, right? It's something that, so this is, so Leonardo da Vinci, right? We think of him as the lone genius, but he was part of a workshop, collective, right? And that's where he learned his skills and his techniques. And then he took it, and at a certain point, he became a leader. And then that leadership gets translated to and passed along to someone else who moves to the head of the swarm. It's like, you know, a flock of birds. You know, at some point or another, every bird rotates into leadership, and others move back. And so there's this back and forth that happens. So it's not necessary, I would argue, that we have to lose our individuality in order to be part of a society or part of a culture. We are both and. It's not necessarily either or, right? And there are times, perhaps, when you take and allow yourself to be led in different directions as you sort of follow after some ideas that are worth pursuing, that you find that you want to replicate, that you would like to do, where you would like to do likewise. But then if you, as you go along, it's very easy for you to move to the place where you're in the forefront, depending on, you know, the trajectory that you take. And so I would just try to alleviate concerns that this is anything about losing one's individuality, because I think even though I'm a part of the American experience, I'm a part of the African-American community, I'm a part of Syracuse University, I'm a part of this group in this room right now, I'm also an individual, right? I think you can do both at the same time. Leadership. Okay, sure. Mm-hmm.
Good evening, everyone. And first of all, before we adjourn to the reception, I think I just want to offer a few words of thanks. And this entire week would not be possible without the hard work of a lot of individuals, a lot of faculty that are here in the room, staff and students. And again, because of Ryan's efforts. So let's give a round of applause to Ryan.
Once again, sorry about that.
I learned something today, so I don't care if Frank Goss has this one. It might be a team day back. We certainly have learned a lot from your discussion tonight, James, and I personally have enjoyed meeting you. You're now part of this community.
Thank you very much.
So, we appreciate the effort and the hard work that you put into tonight's lecture, and we want to invite you back and consider you part of the family. So,
thank you so much.
On behalf of Marymount, please accept this. Small token of our appreciation.
Thank you so much.
Hope you'll display it proudly at Syracuse.
I will. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.